Hey everybody, in this video I want to talk about a fundamental data structure which is widely used today in the field of geometric modeling, called a boundary representation, or BREP for short. The underlying concept for the boundary representation was developed independently by Ian Braid at Cambridge in England and Bruce Baumgard at Computer Vision. The basic idea goes something like this. A solid object has surfaces or faces which form its outer boundary. Each face has a set of boundary curves called edges which define its material region, and an edge has endpoints or vertices which define its outer limits. A BREP gives the computer a way to treat a collection of surfaces as if they're a single object. So for instance, if six faces all meet up to form a cube, it's much easier to treat them as a single connected object and perform operations like trimming the cube or drilling a hole through the cube, rather than continually picking individual faces to work with. Let's look at this in greater detail, beginning with edges. An edge is usually represented by a 3D curve. In most systems, curves are defined parametrically. This gives us a single variable, like t, called the parameter, which corresponds to a position along the curve. The set of possible values for t is called the domain, or parameter space, and as t moves along the parameter space, this corresponds to a point moving along our curve. If you think of the parameter space as representing some time interval, and the curve is the path that we're traveling along, then c of t is our location at time t. We may only use a portion of our curve for an edge, so we create two points which serve as our beginning and ending points. Each point is called a vertex and corresponds to some min and max t value in our parameter space. Note that when we construct our model, a single vertex may be the endpoint of any number of edges. The edges create a skeletal frame which is held together by the vertices. The next level up from an edge is a face. A face is just a surface bounded by a set of edges. As with curves, most modeling systems use a parametric representation for surfaces. Surfaces have 2 degrees of freedom, so they require 2 independent parameters to represent them. U and V are typically used. The parameter space for a surface is usually some rectangular region corresponding to the min and max values of each parameter. Notice that drawing a 2D curve in the parameter space creates a 3D curve on the surface. If we make a set of nested loops out of these UV space curves, then we can define a boundary in the parameter space, which acts like a cookie cutter and defines a region on the face of the surface. A surface region defined by these types of loops is called a trim surface. This makes it very easy to modify a face. For instance, if you want to punch a square region out of a cylinder, then you don't have to change the underlying surface at all. All you have to do is create a new set of edge loops for the surface. These edge loops are referred to as trim loops, and they're usually stored using some type of binary tree, where one branch points to the next loop at the same level, and the other branch points to the first loop inside the current loop. Every time you drop to another inside level, the loop will alternate between being an island or a hole in the current island. In this example, we have 2 outer loops, A and B, that are at the same level. So the next pointer for A is pointing to B, and the next pointer for B is pointing to -1, to indicate it's the end of the linked list of loops at this level. Inside of A, we have 2 loops, C and E, which are at the same level. So A has an end pointer pointing to C, and C has a next pointer pointing to E. Notice that C and E correspond to holes in the island created by loop A. If we drop one more level inside of C, we get the loop D, which again creates an island. Likewise, B has 1 inside loop F, which in turn has 2 inside loops G and H. Most modeling systems prefer to have their faces stored with only 1 outer loop and 1 level of inner loop nesting. Hence, for the examples we just showed, this would likely be broken up into 5 separate faces before adding to the database. Modeling systems should be able to support these general cases since they may occur while performing some geometric operation. The modeling system can break these up into valid faces at the end of the operation. Our boundary representation is the topological glue that connects all of our surfaces together. At the highest level, all the faces that are connected form what's called a shell, and shells may be nested just like loops to create our final shape. A shape may only consist of a single shell, or it may have void regions inside bounded by other shells. Most modeling systems also assume that we are only allowing manifold shapes. The mathematical definition for a shape to be a manifold requires that every point on the shape has some sphere centered at that point that is divided into exactly 2 regions, 1 inside and 1 outside. Ultimately, every manufacturable part will be a manifold shape. But as we mentioned before, it's possible that your geometry may pass through some intermediate stages during an operation where it becomes non-manifold. So now let's look at a typical BREP database using a cylinder as our example. We assume here our cylindrical shape consists of three surfaces sewn together. When a surface like the middle tube wraps back around on itself, we say the surface is closed, and the edge where they meet is called a seam. Our cylindrical shape consists of a single shell. A database representation of our shell records should contain or point to a list of faces. These faces represent the connected outer boundary of the shell. Here our shell record has a table with three faces, which are labeled in the diagram on the right. The shell record should have in and next pointers in case we have disjoint or nested shells to create voids in our shape. Notice that each face has a pointer to a loop record. Our BREP needs to have a table of loop records. Each trim face must have some set of curves defined in the parameter space of the base surface. These parameter space curves have different names in different systems. They're called loop curves, UV curves, co-edges, bends, pre-edges, and sometimes half-edges. The important thing is that these 2D curves are not edges. As a parameter space curve moves along the surface, we can create a 3D curve. The 3D curve created by the UV curve and the surface is the actual edge. Notice that each loop curve has a pointer to an edge. The edge record corresponds to a 3D curve. It points to the vertices at each endpoint, and it also points back to the UV curves that match it. By doing this, adjacent surfaces are attached along the edge. In a manifold system, each edge only points to two faces. This allows geometric algorithms to act on multiple faces. When some operation hits the outer loop of one face, it jumps to the edge to find what other face is also attached to it, and then continues working on the new face. The final structure will look something like this in the database. A shape record points to the set of shell records. Each shell contains a list of its boundary faces. Each face points to a list of loops, which form the inner and outer boundary of the face on the surface. Each loop contains a list of pre-edges or UV curves, each of which points to its associated edge. And finally, the edge points to any vertices at the extreme ends of its domain. It's also sometimes helpful to have the vertex records point back to the shape record. This avoids confusion matching vertices from different shapes, which can result in non-manifold geometry being created. It's also common for each vertex to contain a list of all the edges that are attached to it. In summary, a boundary representation is a theoretical model for storing geometric shapes. While it may seem a bit cumbersome at first, you will quickly see that it is in fact a very simple and efficient approach for modeling and manipulating geometric objects. I hope you found this video helpful. Please feel free to leave comments and suggestions, and thanks for watching.